Hello, and I hope you're doing well. Please pay no mind to Death. He's been over here playing some video games for a while. It's like Ico from the Ico and Shadow of the Colossus pack. It's for the PS3. Great game, by the way. Hey, at that one part, you're going to want to... Alright, there. Calm down. He's one of those sensitive types. Yes, you are. Come on, I know that you took that Myers-Briggs personality test. What are you, an IFP, right? INFJ? Yeah. Although, I have to admit, I'm a sensitive myself. I think whenever I've taken one of those free Myers-Briggs tests online, I always ended up with like an INFP or an INFJ. So, you know, you gotta take those with a grain of salt. Anyway, I have with me, by the way, I figured while Death is here binging on video games, taking a break from his, you know, duties, I would mic up his video game controller. So as you can already hear, I thought it would make for some nice relaxing background sounds instead of just the sound of my voice. I hope you like it. Anyway, I have with me the existential questionnaire. Now, I wasn't going to do this video. I don't like to do a video on the same topic back-to-back, like with back-to-back, you know, as far as one video and the next, or back-to-back within like a week's time. But I saw a comment by someone that said something along the lines that... they would have liked to hear, you know, my thoughts on these questions. So, you know, it doesn't take much to twist my arm to get me to talk about something that I'm interested in. And plus, I have all the answers anyway. So, I am going to go through all the questions and share my thoughts. Those of you who are, subscribers, that you... probably already know what my answers are going to be for the most part. But I thought I would do the first video just to raise the questions and not answer them myself and just kind of, you know, let people think and make a relaxing thing. I really wasn't going to do this, have a discussion, but so thanks to the viewer, you know who you are. Here we are. Let me get rid of these because I can't hardly see up close with them anymore. Okay, so the first question was, who are you? And this is one of those questions that, you know, I ponder myself from time to time, you know. Who are we? Are we what society wants us to be? What our peers want us to be? Do you even know who you are? I mean, you think about it. Am I a YouTuber? Well yeah, but that's a label. I mean, that kind of explains what I do. Am I a nihilist? Maybe a little bit. Now, I can identify with these different types of things, anarcho-communist, a little bit, a gamer, a foodie, you know, and on and on. But, you know, who am I really, though? Like, I'm not, like, a nihilist all the time. I can identify with, maybe to a certain degree, I am. I'm a human being, right? To me, those things are very superficial. The YouTuber. I'm not a YouTuber. You know, I make videos, and my primary creative outlet, is YouTube. But when I'm not doing this, I'm not a YouTuber when I'm grocery shopping, I'm not a nihilist when I'm hanging out with my son and, or, my wife and family, and we're having fun, So I think the real question is, like, who are we underneath all those things? Like, I'm not a, when I vote, are you, you vote Democrat or Republican, maybe you don't vote, right? You might identify, someone might identify as a Democrat. But, is that really what you are? You get rid of all that, those superficial descriptions. You're a human being, right? I'm a human being. I identify with a lot of these different things, just like anyone else might identify with. But is that really who I am? Am I really a nihilist and all these things? Or am I just a culmination of everything that I have learned and have been taught? Am I all of these things because that's what I've learned? Those are the things that I can agree with. But again, when you take those away, who are we? Underneath all that, I don't have any. This is very off the cuff, and it's not supposed to be something where I'm going to provide examples and do a ton of research on what different philosophers and much brighter minds than me have discussed on the subject. Otherwise, this would be like a 5-hour video with a half an hour on each a question. But you just wonder, are we the things that make us? Am I the shoes, that I wear, the watches, the political affiliation, all that stuff? It's one of those things. It's the question isn't so much that, I'm just a human being and these are the things that I've been taught. The question is more about, are you what the superficial things describe you as? Are you the hat and the clothes? Are you a trend? Are you what you, perception that you show to others? No. I mean, do you even know who you are? I mean, because, I used to be a kid and I was Roman Catholic and I was Christian, And then I was like, well, no, that's not who I am. I don't believe in God. And it took me, 10, 20 years to realize I'm a godless animal. Because we'll get into that question. So that's kind of the answer, I think, for that one. Okay, next question. Why are you here? What is your purpose? Do you have one? Again, last time I'm going to say this, another one of those timeless questions. I'm not going to say that every time because I could with a lot of these. A lot of people think we're here to serve God. Some people think we're here just, I don't know, there's probably a lot of different answers, but again, from my perspective, why am I here? it really depends, I guess, on how I might want to feel, the way I feel that I want to answer that. It depends on the mood I'm in, maybe. My purpose, Well, now that we have a son, my purpose is all the fatherhood responsibilities, doing all that fatherly stuff, you know, the husbandry stuff. Beyond that, I guess my purpose is to do this, try to make people think, make people laugh, be thought-provoking, you know, take risks. I've always been a risk-taker, to create, I guess, to observe, and to regurgitate those observations, you know, just to unload everything on my mind. I don't feel I have a purpose. I don't really, you know, wake up and think anything as far as, like, oh, this is my purpose and this, that. I don't really, you know, I'm very unorthodox, I guess, and sporadic, maybe. Yeah, I think my purpose is just to try to make sure I do what I can in whatever system I'm in, capitalist, communist, anarcho-communist, socialist, play by the rules so I can be free, have food in the fridge, do my best to help raise our family and all that, be a good citizen, pay my taxes, you know, be kind to people out there in the real world that I encounter, and, you know, just eat and avoid dying. That's pretty much my purpose, you know, and I guess continue making YouTube videos until the day I'm dead, I guess. Oh, and then does a porpoise have a purpose? Does a tortoise have a purpose? Again, you know, does anything have a purpose? Well, you know, since I don't believe in God, no, I just think the earth, everything was created randomly. I mean, there may be some, a system, you know, with the, what is it, the golden, the Fibonacci numbers and the golden, I forget, all that, you know, with math, you know, the universe came out a certain way, not by design, by any god or sentient creature, but just the way math works, you know, the earth and the moon and everything and the Milky Way, you know, just it's kind of the form just kind of created it. And then life on earth happened, and then we evolved, and, you know, we're just a happy accident. Happy accident, unhappy accident, depending upon how you look at it, you know, deforestation, violence, etc. So, does a porpoise and a tortoise have a purpose? Yeah. No, nothing really has a purpose in my mind. You know, things just exist, they eat, they breed, they try to keep from dying, avoid getting eaten. And that's it. Just to exist is their purpose. That's what I think. I'm not really sure which order I did these questions in the previous video, but I'm going to go through them the way I have them listed here. I might have jumped around. Is Cthulhu benevolent, or is he in cahoots with the professor? Not really an existential question, but, no, I guess, you know, it could be a little bit. No, why is, what was the true purpose for bringing Cthulhu to Arkham Sanitarium? You know, was the professor using Cthulhu for his own means and purposes? Which, if you ask me, probably think so. Or does Cthulhu have a mind of his own? And is he using the professor, Dave, Margaret, et al., for his own means, you know, kind of a two. What would you say that? You know, each one is using each other, I guess. Not sure there's a certain phrase for that. But it remains to be seen. You know, probably find out in the maybe a little bit more what's going on when Cthulhu comes back as a doctor. And Santa, and the Easter Bunny, and a barber. What is the meaning of life? Ah, yes. What is the meaning of life? Again, from my, I guess you would say, nihilistic perspective. Nihilist, but I'm an optimist. I'm a cynic and a skeptic. I'm a glass half full. I know what people are capable of. I know the greatness in people. Some people, not everyone. You know, humans are like the yin and yang. You know, the black and white, the circle. You know? But I don't think there is a meaning to life. I think it's up to you to create your own meaning, which I kind of answered in the question. You know, I've explored all of these questions. You know, being raised Roman Catholic, I can't remember now, but I'm sure back then as a kid, you know, we're all, you know, when you're a kid, when you're a teen, you're very simple-minded. Your brain isn't open up to a lot of concepts, like, you know, atheism or nihilism quite yet, right? I mean, depending upon your exposure to those things, but back in the 70s or 80s, a lot of that stuff, you know, we didn't talk about with the kids that I knew at Catholic school whenever sat around discussing God or atheism. But, you know, sure, at some point, I guess I thought the meaning of life was, not that I thought about the meaning of life in that way as a Catholic kid, but I'm sure my mindset was that I play, I have fun, and I worship God, and I, you know, I don't break the commandments, I don't break laws, and I'm a good boy, I'm a good soldier. I do what I'm told, and, you know, I guess to worship God and be good is the meaning of life. And then, you know, I get away from all, you know, I reach the age of reason, what I like to call it, when you be able to start reasoning and thinking for yourself and questioning everything, becoming a critical thinker, a free thinker. And I was used to be in those existential moments of dread. It can be very depressing. And, you know, I just, you know, over the last, you know, 5 years maybe, probably have come more with grips with the fact that there is no meaning. And it's up to me to make my own meaning. Because one day, it's bye-bye. I won't even know that it's bye-bye. You know, unless I'm fortunate to kind of go out, you know, peacefully. But, you know, it's not always the case. Yeah, so, and, you know, I'm not afraid of that. I don't have fear. I have certain fears. I'm not afraid of the act of dying. And I'm cool with the fact that my life has no meaning besides what I make for it. Because it's up to me to decide. You know, no one else. It's up to me to forge my own path and do what I want to do. Go about it however I want to go about it. I don't answer anyone. Yeah, I mean, outside of family, you know. But, yeah. And that's it. That's what I think everyone is able to just forge their own path. So, speaking of free, forging a path, are we truly free? Well, yes and no. Yes, we're truly free because, from my perspective, we're godless animals, so we're free to do whatever we want. You can kill. I'm not saying you're free to kill. I'm not condoning that. Let's make sure we get, you know, get that straight. But as a godless animal, you have no inherent system of checks that will prevent you from, you know, murdering someone or killing out of self-defense. I mean, you see it all the time. But, you know, are we truly free from as a citizen? Now, I'm not very familiar with being a citizen in any other country. But as far as being a citizen here in the United States, no, I'm not truly free. Of course not. I can't go out onto a patch of land and build a house and live there and raise farm without what? Oh, I gotta get a permit. I gotta pay taxes. I gotta adhere to all these laws and blah, blah, blah. Because it's all about money. So, I'm not truly free. And it sounds, I know how that sounds. You start talking like, oh, I'm not truly free. You start to sound like there's a stigma out there. When if you start talking about anti-capitalism or anarchism, or you're not free, and you start to, you know, there's a stigma that, you're a troublemaker, or you're a terrorist, or you're even crazy, right? And all that. As if having any kind of alternative lifestyle or view that's not status quo means you know, you're crazy or a terrorist. There's a lot of that stigma out there. A lot of small-minded people and the sheep. But, no, of course, we're not truly free. I mean, if I was, you know, for number one, I have to adhere to the rules and laws of my local governments and federal governments. I live in Pennsylvania. So at a very basic, am I free level? No, I'm not, because I can't, for instance, go to out of state, purchase alcohol and bring it into my state, even though it's just one big rock, just one big piece of land. There's an imaginary border, and oh, I can't cross that border and bring this little man-made substance that's gonna cause inebriation and make me inebriated. So I can't do that because some mostly white politicians said I can't at some point way back in probably the 1700s or 1800s or whatever. not
truly free. I can't, you know, smoke cannabis if I wanted to.
Now for more a complicated in-depth, am I truly free? Like I said, that's like the basic stuff, right? Oh, well, that's, you know, blah, blah, blah. But again, I can't just step out of the system and be a truly free human being here in Pennsylvania and take the family if I wanted to and say, hey, we're going to go to, you know, some other part of Pennsylvania and find open land, and that's not farmed or belong to anyone else, and stake claim to it and build a house and do all this stuff because government. I can't, like I said earlier. So you're free, but within the confines of these systems, these cages.
Now, in regards to murdering and stealing and those things, yeah, I'd have no problem with that. I'm not looking to steal or murder anyone. But it's a lot of the other laws and regulations that don't make sense, especially like same-sex marriage, you know, preventing the people. It's not an issue anymore, I don't think. Maybe certain states still. I don't know if it's still an ongoing thing. I don't really keep track. But, I mean, just, you know, think about that. If people want to engage in the act of getting married, who cares, man? If someone wants to marry a rock or a dog or, two women want to get married, or two guys, or two women and one guy, or one guy, two women and a dog, they all want to get married, you know, let them, man. Humans. Okay, next question. Is it possible for humans to live without condiments, such as ketchup and mustard? That's very, very difficult question to ask. Death says no, it's not. I kind of agree. I don't think I could go without ketchup or mustard or relish. Without them being in my diet. I don't think I could eat a plain hot dog or hamburger. Yeah, so I think condiments, I don't know, that's really an existential question, you know, but it kind of is, because what would my existence be? Who am I without condiments? That's that first question. Who am I? Who are you? I am my condiments. I am ketchup. I am mustard. I am a nihilist. You know, like I said, I'm a godless animal. But I'm a ketchup on my hot dog. Sometimes mustard on my hot dog. Godless animal. Relish. Onions. Chopped onions. Fresh chopped onions. Can't think of any other condiments right now. But, yeah. What is death? Or who is death? What is death? You know, what happens when we die? That's probably one of the more scary existential questions to think about. And there are moments when thinking about that, especially as a father, fills me with dread, sadness, and depression. You know, having it at some point, saying goodbye to all this, knowing that there are some things that I'm not going to be able, I won't have ever accomplished or have done. I mean, you can only do so many things anyway. But, you know, maybe I want to go see Greenland or the Orkney Isles, or wish I could have tried doing stand-up comedy, or try to direct a film or write a book. You know, that stuff is kind of trivial. As long as I can kind of stay alive long enough for certain other things to be seen through, that's good enough for me. But saying goodbye, I think, will be the hardest part of dying. For me, that's probably how it is for everyone. The act of dying and going through that, the pain, whatever, you know, yeah, it's going to be probably terrifying, but just knowing that it's going to be all gone and there's no afterlife, I don't, you know, because I'm a godless animal, I don't think there is an afterlife. That actually gives me more reason to live now, and to be happy now, and to not really give a crap about, you know, all these, well, yeah, there are certain rules that I follow. Like I said, I don't break the law or anything, but I don't drink and drive and all that stuff. But I live as free as I can within this cage. And without any regrets, I've got nothing to lose.
any day anything could happen to me. I've gotten this far. No, I'm, you know, in my mid-40s. So that times 365 days a year is, no, I can't math right now, but that's what, 13, 14,000 days, something like that. You know, I'm knock on wood. I'm very fortunate to be alive. A lot of people, you know, famous folks, not famous folks have kicked the bucket at my age already or younger. So I don't think there's an afterlife. I'm not worried about it. Like I said, I live because I really don't have anything to lose. And, you know, I don't answer to a higher power. You know, I answer only to the folks that I know and love. I don't think there's any kind of spiritual energy or anything like that. I know it can sound very depressing, but it's actually quite the opposite. You know, once, you know, you go through that, you know, you go through that whole thought process and examining and analyzing, you know, wow, there might not be a heaven, you know, especially with me being raised Roman Catholic. Heaven and hell was like, you know, I got to be good, I must behave, or I'm going to burn in hell. I must do, follow the commandments, and yes, obey my, you know, be that robot. And, you know, and then I, you know, came to grips with, you know, the fact that that's probably all BS, most likely. And, yeah, so yeah, I'm cool with the fact that this is it. You know, even if there isn't, if I come back or there's an afterlife, or if there's a God and there's an all-loving God, you know, supposedly as a lot of people think, then he's going to be cool with this because I'm human and I don't know that he exists and he doesn't make his presence known to me. And if he exists and he's not making his presence known to me and he loves me, then he'll love me because he knows that I'm a fallible human. You know, we're all fallible humans. So when I kick the bucket and I, if there is the pearly gates, and he'll be like, yeah, it's all good. Come in. Yeah, you're, you know. So, but no, total cessation of consciousness when I go. And I'm cool with that. Bury me in the ground. I don't want a casket. I don't want to take up space in the cemetery. Bury me in the ground, plant a tree, you know, let my body go back and provide nutrients, you know, back to the earth. You know, recycle me. So that's really it. And I think, you know, for me, it just relieves a lot of stress and worry. Because, you know, I'm not worried about having to be a certain way. I can live my life how I so please, wherever I so choose. You know, I've got nothing to lose, no regrets. There's nothing waiting for me. There's no paradise. There's no hell. This is it. So I can live as just a person. And I could be an individualist. It's to each their own. Can choose however we want to live and not having all that stuff with the religion. And even though I still got to live within the confines of the government, which is fine for the most part, I don't really drink anymore. So I'm not worried about carrying alcohol across state lines. I don't really smoke anymore, so I'm not worried about the price and the taxes of cigarettes. I'm not worried, you know, I don't drink and drive and all that. So, yeah, I don't really have a problem with authority. Too much. I have a problem with the system and all that, but that's, you know, a different topic. So, all right, is there a God? No. I mean, I don't think there is a God. Well, you know, first off, one has never made it, himself, herself, itself known to me. That's number one. Number two, there's like 2,000 religions, right? There's Jesus Christ, there's God, there's Allah. I don't know what the Hindus believe in Zeus, Norse gods, Norse mythology, you know, all that. So, you know, which is the right god, you know? Being raised Roman Catholic, I was taught to believe, and that's where our beliefs come from, as Bill Hicks said, and I keep saying him because I don't want to come across like I'm saying, and I gotta make sure I give credit where credit is due. It's just what we were taught. It doesn't make them real. No, Jesus Christ, God, it's just what we've been taught. You don't know about a God until you are taught about a God. I mean, think about that. If a God existed, you would have an intrinsic, built-in knowledge of that. And it would be, I know of this certain God that exists. And you wouldn't have to be taught it. That's, I mean, if I was a kind of God, that's the kind of line that I would make, connect with my creations. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure there's not a God. And if there is, it's not some kind of the human vision of a God. Like, you know, Jesus, the Son of God, or Allah, whatever. There's probably not any kind of sentient God. Who knows? Probably something beyond our human comprehension. But I don't think there is a God. Not the way that most people tend to think about some kind of sentient, omnipotent being. No, I think God is just a science, just all that, you know? The gravity, the whatever caused the universe to come into being. But that's not really your typical God, right? You know? So, yeah, I don't think there's any kind of higher power. That's what I'm trying to talk about. If you want to say God is the stuff of science, you know, and the laws of nature, okay, but that's not really your typical higher power type of God, right? It's not a thinking, sentient thing. It's just energy, you know? So, but maybe there is a God when you get down into those, what is it, smaller than the atoms, the quarks. I'm not sure how far down they can go, but maybe down inside there. Or maybe there is a God, and he created, you know, the Milky Way, the armpit, you know, this armpit of the universe. And us humans, and, but, you know, he went off, somewhere else. I mean, there's how many ever universes that he created, or she, or it, you know, who knows, but, nah, I don't think there's a God. Why does Margaret wear a mask? Because she's hot, is because, her face, is she scared, is blah, blah, blah. There's a couple of schools of thought when it comes to Margaret. Number one is, you know, who is Margaret? Some think that it's the professor. The professor had a wife. He lost her in some tragic accident, and so he portrays himself as his wife. Some think that he brought his wife, reanimated her. Via what he learned from Herbert West while they were colleagues at Miskatonic University. Who knows? I don't know. I can't answer that. I wouldn't answer it if I did know it. She remains an enigma. She's a mystery. But maybe one day we'll get an answer. Or maybe not. Probably not. Was there ever a beginning to the universe? Ah, yes. The beginning of the universe, the Big Bang. What came before the Big Bang? It's like, you know, what came first, the chicken or the egg? It's one of those things that's impossible to fathom. You get stuck. Just like, how can something come from nothing? There always has to be a something from which the, you know, something came from, the Big Bang, right, or whatever, you go back, there's got to be there can't just be a nothing starting point, like just emptiness, and then all of a sudden what? So, where did the first, you know, if it's just a constant cycle of energy, how did the energy come about? Was there a God at some point, and then he died, or it died, she died, whatever. And, you know, there's lots of different theories, of course, but it's just going to be one of those things that we can guess, but we'll never know. It's beyond us. Are we alive, or is this a simulation? A couple years ago, I think it was one of my siblings who brought it to my attention. I forget the name of it. There's a website about this theory that some distant future, we gain so much advanced technology, we are able to actually simulate human life to every finest details. So they posit the theory, or pose the theory, that we are simulation, and that we wouldn't know because, the simulation wouldn't have to create everything beyond our, the interactions that we have. Like, for instance, right now, I'm in this room, and so the simulation engine wouldn't have to really generate anything outside beyond this room visually. And everything that actually happens to other people like yourself and all that, it records the data like a sim game, so it's all happening at once. You know, so it's along those lines. And that, you know, you simulate a human life, death, pain, you can simulate that. You know, is it possible? Anything's possible. I'm not one of those folks to believe that that's true. It's something to think about. It's possible, but I don't know. I mean, you sometimes wonder about fate and synchronicity and ghosts and things like that, and maybe there's like a 0.0001% of me that could give a little bit of credence to the simulation, just with how I ended up here and some of the choices I made and just weird things that happened in life and all this stuff. And maybe, but I don't know. And with like 8 billion people, maybe there aren't 8 billion people. I mean, you could really throw out some supporting or give some legitimate supporting arguments to the possibility of there being, that we're living in a simulation, as much as you could try to disprove it. But I'm gonna err on the side of caution and say probably not. But no, because nothing, is making itself known to me that, I don't ever see a glitch and then see, like, whatever I would see if there was a glitch in this simulation. Maybe that's what ghosts are. Yeah, you never know. Maybe when you go to bed and you have a dream, maybe that's you being outside the simulation. I don't know. It's one of those interesting things to think about, Why is a repairman fixated with making repairs? Is it just his job? I don't know, who is this mysterious repairman? And why is he always trying to repair you? I don't know. Again, it's, where did the professor find him? Is he a repairman? Is he a patient? Why is he so fascinated with making repairs? Is it just his job? Is it his job because he's just good at it? again, it's kind of one of those questions. What's his purpose? Who is he? I don't know. Maybe one day the repairman will provide us with those answers. Are you really in control of your own thoughts, words, and actions? So, I don't know if I've ever really researched this. I don't think I've found this anywhere on the internet. But this is something I feel that I've come up with myself. I don't know. I can't remember now if I saw it somewhere and decided to think about it. We think we're in control, like right now. I'm making this video. But am I really, is this a really conscious decision? Or is this the culmination of everything I've been taught and all my experiences? And those things are predicate, I don't want to use too big words because sometimes I forget how to use them. They are leading me up to do this. If you take away everything, what you're getting into a question of what is consciousness. We don't know that, right? You know, what is, you know, there, how many billions of neurons in there? And we don't really know completely how the mind works. So am I talking now? Is this me consciously? What is me? Who am I? You know, inside here. Is there this ego, this id, you know? Is it just something in there that's taking all the stuff that I absorb, taking through my senses, everything I've been learned, everything I've been taught, what I learn, what I seek out, it goes in here. But what's the thing that's telling me to make this video? What's the, you know, what is all that? You know, which decides, you know, what I do, what I don't? Is that really me making that decision? I sometimes wonder, you know, I don't really know how to answer that. I feel like I'm in conscious control of what I do. I'm not talking like I'm a robot. I don't mean like that I'm getting programmed to do all this. But, no, it's really hard to unlearn, to think about unlearning everything that you've learned, you know, knowledge, and go back to an infant stage and put yourself in there and think about, you know, how much is instinct, how much is that, you know, that animal instinct, and what's going on in the brain. Again, that's making me make this video. Am I really sitting there going through, you know, everything I can possibly do, which I you know, I feel aware that I can go through my catalog of knowledge, personal knowledge and experience and choices and say, well, do I want to go out and steal a car or do I want to make a video? But what is that that's making me have those thoughts? That's kind of the question. Am I really in control of the choices or is something in here? I mean, you're looking at me, you're seeing my mouth move, my eyes and all that's happening. That's just the surface. What's really going on is deep in here. The brain is a million things firing, and those are controlling the motor actions. And the brain is, you know, wants to, I guess my brain wants to express myself, express itself, you know? But why? What's the purpose, you know, and all that? So, I like to think I'm in control, that we're in control. You know, of our own lives. With me being a godless animal, I don't feel that I'm on any kind of set path or I have strings being pulled for me. Sometimes I feel, though, that what has happened in my life is often a little too odd to just be random. So I give a little bit of credence to fate and synchronicity, but I'm not too much. I'm not a spiritualist or anything like that. I sometimes think maybe I'm not in control. Maybe I am doing the things that all these the things that I hear and the things that I see that I read, those go in here into my brain. And something is there, I think the me that's in control, the conscious me, is saying, okay, I'm going to do that. But what is that me? Again, what is the me that's saying I'm going to do that? Maybe that me is the, I don't know. I can't, I hit a smart, I kind of hit my level there. I'm beyond my depth, I think, at this point. So we're gonna end it there. I just think it might be possible that I'm not in control. That something is. I'm not saying that if I were to go out and commit a crime, that I'm not in control. That's not what I mean. I mean that I think I have the awareness and the control of the things that I do. Okay, I'm not saying that I'm never, you know, not taking personal responsibility, but what is the thing that I'm, the self-awareness, you know, what is all that that's going on in there? So, can the humans across the globe coexist in peace and harmony without violence and war? Well, we're animals. We're part of the animal kingdom. There is no God. People can do whatever they want. They have done it. We're a brutal animal at times. I don't think you'll ever get rid of violence and war unless you do some kind of genetic engineering to get rid of all those feelings and things, and you just make sure everyone is born with empathy, compassion, and that stuff. But I don't think you should do that. I think everyone has the right to live however they want, and that's kind of the animal kingdom. That's nature. There's going to be violence and anger. It's part of who we are. It's our right to do what we want. It would be nice if people didn't commit crimes and violence, but you know, people aren't born serial murderers. And things like that. There's lots of different contributing factors, predisposition, yeah, you know, to those things, mental health issues, society, other people, and all that, right? So it's a culmination of different things. In a perfect world, I mean, violence is just a part of who we are, a part of being an animal. If I want to go take something from someone, or mistreat someone, I have that right. I don't answer to no one. But I don't live that way, you know? I respect other people's freedoms out there in the real world. That's just how it's going to be. You're never going to take... You can take the human out of the jungle, but you can't take the jungle out of the human. Can you have your cake and eat it too? It's a tough one. I mean, there's that can apply. It can have a little bit of a different answer, I think, based on, you know, you got, you know, it's political, it's moral. I think it's there. I don't think there's any real one way to answer that. That's in general. Well, I mean, it could depend on the type of cake too. I mean, you know, if it's a German chocolate cake, I think you need to share that a little bit. If it's a, what's that, fruit cake, Christmas time, I think you re-gift that. But I think you should share your cake. I really do, because there's a lot of ingredients that went into it. And you didn't make all of those ingredients, unless you have the cocoa bean grown in your yard, and you have sugar cane, and you have wheat. That's cocoa, sugar,
flour, milk, and you got cows. If you have all those things and you can actually use your own resources to make your own cake, then I think you can eat your own cake too. You can have it and eat it. You can make it, right? But no, I mean, if the cake isn't a lie to begin with. So that's the assumption. The cake is not a lie. We have to make sure that's understood. But yeah, I think we need to share the cake and our cakes. Really do. I mean, that's how we got this far as a species, not being individuals, working together, community. A collective of, you know, it's good to be your own individual. We are a collective of individuals, which I think is okay, but we really need to coexist and work together and not be separated. So anyway, we should divide the cake up, but everyone should get a nice equal, you know, we're not talking pie, okay? Equal share of the pie, piece of the pie, the cake. It's different. This is no existential questionnaire about pie. Maybe in the next existential questionnaire, okay? This is cake, so I think you can have your cake. I think you can eat it as long as you share it. So maybe I just answered it, maybe. I think so. Is there a right or wrong, or is it all just learned behavior? Do morals truly exist? I don't know. I think some of it's learned behavior, you know. Be polite, be courteous. I think there's a lot of emphasis on don't be offensive. Don't, you know, be courteous, be kind. I think there's a lot of that. But I don't think you have to be. You can just take whatever you want from anyone you want. You're an animal. You don't answer to anyone. Like I said, there's no God. I can, if I wanted to do things and break the law, I have that freedom. I'm not going to do it. I don't condone it. Again, I got to say that. But, you know, I kind of like not being in jail. Never been convicted of anything either. I don't think there's really a right or wrong. I think, well, it's really hard to say. It's really hard to go back to that pre-behavior when you're talking about right or wrong. Because, I mean, look at it. At kids, toddlers, before they really understand right or wrong. You know, they want to take something and they want to do this. They don't really have that awareness of right or wrong. So I think a lot of it's learned behavior. I don't think there's anything intrinsic, that, like, an invisible barrier that stops me from doing anything. I mean, right? I mean, if murder was a wrong, you know, this is kind of the thing about, you know, God. If God didn't want us to murder, if it was against his, the Christian, God didn't want us to murder and was against his law, then he would have built within us a thing that, you know, why would he say, thou shalt not kill, you know, in the Ten Commandments? I mean, that's kind of a lazy way of being a God. Here, I'm going to, you know, you're going to have to rely on your own free will. You just don't kill. Now, I'm going to give you free will. Just don't kill. Just, you know, I think I would have built some kind of intrinsic thing that is like a, you know, you can't even go to kill. Like, no, I don't want to kill. I can't do it. There's no. Because there's just free will, godless free will. I think there's probably no right or wrong, but we put those rules into place for some practical purposes, so we're not all living, you know, we're torturing people and stealing from one another. Okay, it's kind of nice to have your freedom without having your freedoms constantly tread upon, unlike probably some other countries or whatever. I think there's a practical purpose for having morals, rights or wrongs, but I don't think there's anything natural. It's just learned behavior, I think. Like I said, I to really explore and to get more opinions and different things on each of these questions, it'd probably take, you know, 15, 20 minutes for each question. I'm already taking quite a lot of time as it is. But you know, from what the things that I've done and from what I observed other people do, humans do, you know, the violence and everything from the good to the bad, everything kind of points to the fact that there's no right or wrong. It's not even anything that makes sense. Why do some people experience ASMR and others do not? Is there a purpose? Is there a correlation between being a highly sensitive person, which is a thing, and having empathy? I think so. From what I observed, it's, a lot of people tend to be, who experience ASMR, tend to be very sensitive. I don't know if they are, that's always a truth. Empathy. I sometimes think that empathy is a genetic trait. Some people have it, some people don't. I think there is a correlation there, but can people experience ASMR that are not empathetic? I don't know. There are people that are not highly sensitive experience ASMR? I don't know. I mean, who isn't a highly sensitive person? A highly sensitive person is someone, it isn't like a superpower. It's a trait that has been observed to occur in certain higher species, humans being one of them, although we could probably debate whether or not humans are a higher species. And highly sensitive just means that certain people have a very sensitive nervous system, meaning they... the way their eyes work, their hearing, they can pick up details, things like that. They're good at analyzing, picking up a lot of the fine details. They are like the priests, the advisors of the species, the people who are not highly sensitive. They're like the warriors, the gladiators, the fighters, and those people tend to not exhibit, probably, since they're not highly sensitive, empathy. And they might just kind of, you would think they might be a bully. They're not a bully. They just, and you think they're uncaring, and they're not sensitive to, they don't see the fine details in it. But that doesn't, you know, mean they're less human. It's the type of person that they are. But anyway, enough about that. What is, why do some people experience ASMR? I think there might be a correlation, just based on my observations, simple observations. It's, you don't need to be a rocket scientist. What is its purpose? I don't know. You know, it's one of those things. Some people experience it, some people don't. Maybe it's just a genetic thing that a certain group of type of humans, you know, like having green eyes, you know, whatever, and I don't know really the genetic purpose or significance of it. That's kind of the mystery of life, right? Randomness. Genetic mutations, you'd have to, I don't know if there's any been studies or theories out there as to why it exists, but yeah, you know, the whole communal thing, grooming way back when we were
Neanderthals or whatever. So maybe this mutation came about and creates this sensation, maybe it's like a genetic mutation of goosebumps or the chills, you know. And it just has been passed on. How did that genetic mutation come about and why? That's kind of the question behind this, you know. I don't know, but it's it exists, and it's a pretty big industry, money-making industry now, it seems like. Are we alone in the universe, or universes? I don't know, they both sound weird. Probably not. I mean, with as expansive as the universe apparently is, if we're not in a simulation, or if we are in a simulation, and if there is more than one universe, whether it's a hologram or a parallel universes and all this stuff, you would think there's a probability. How great or small, I don't know. It's probably a probable probability that there has to be life on another planet. I mean, really, Earth, everything, just, this is it? This is the only planet that has life? I can't imagine. But maybe there was, maybe there is. What does it look like? Is all life always going to be the same like it is on Earth? Is that really the only formula? A sun, a certain distance from the Earth, a moon, you know, water, plant life, and animals on this planet. Would everything end up the same way on every other planet? Is there other kind of life forms, like, you know, sentient creatures made of gas, or, you don't know, like the things that you see in any kind of weird alien movie? Do grays exist, you know, humanoids with, I don't know, six arms and mouths in their chest, or no heads? You know, think of something that's, you know, random and weird. I don't know. Hard to fathom, but I suppose it's probably a probability. Probably never know about it, though. Maybe we will one day. Should they ever have made a sequel to Rambo? Nah, I don't think so. Rambo was a great flick when it came out, and it was that period, you know, Rambo, a lot of there was Terminator, there was a couple Schwarzenegger flicks, it was all that testosterone, hothead, macho, you know, guns, and all that stuff, all that crap. But Rambo was a good movie for its time. Nothing against Sylvester Stallone. You know, he's doing something that I could never do. Well, maybe I could have if I knew how to do it when I was a kid. Anyway, you know, but a lot of people seem to be actors, so it doesn't seem to be too hard of a thing. It's kind of difficult to get into. Anyway, I liked Rambo. And when it's on, if I'm in the right mood, you know, it's a good movie, but I don't think they should have ever made a sequel to it. I didn't even see the sequel. I don't even need to. Well, did I see a sequel? I can't remember. I might have. But anyway, no, I some sequels I like. I like the Alien franchise of sequels. You know, the whole whether or not they should ever made a sequel thing is always going to be up for debate. I think it should just be one and done. You know, I think a lot of sequels are to make money, to milk the product for all that you can. I'm trying to remember if there are some decent sequels that come to mind. Well, you know, Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back was the best, Return of the Jedi was good, except for the Ewoks. So there's some good sequels there. You know, some of the Star Trek. You know, Wrath of Khan. Maybe not anything after that. Not anything after Ghostbusters. We probably could go on and on, but yeah, probably should have just made Rambo and that was it. What do people need most in the world? Depends on the perspective, I guess. Obviously, food and water. But beyond that, I think companionship. I think we need each other. I think we are social creatures, but things happen that make us antisocial or misanthropists. The way societies are set up, these systems, these governments, these economic systems, they can, and the way certain people think, you know, the violence, certain acts of violence that people do can turn us good people into being antisocial and wanting less to do with each other. You know, besides the basic necessities, food and water, shelter, medicine, that's good to have. But I think we need companionship. I really do. And why is ASMR so popular? Because a lot of people aren't getting the attention that they need or they want, and they can't find it. I'm not saying they're lonely. Now, I know a lot of people use the videos for rest, relaxation. I'm aware of that. But I think the social aspect, the companionship, not necessarily, I mean, even just platonic relationships, the community. We don't seem to be much of a community, really, of people. And we get together. I mean, I'm not, online, it doesn't count. I'm talking about in the real world, where it really counts. You know, the virtual stuff will never compare to physical, real world connections. Even just, that's why I like the idea of living in small groups, or having, you live in communities where you're growing stuff in your backyard, and you're making stuff, and every day you go out, you bring it out to the streets, everyone just does that, because that's the utopian society, that's what you do, and we're interacting with one another, we know each other, we're neighborly, there's none of that really too much. It depends on the neighborhood. I mean, it can, but so many people move. So many people are isolated. Kids are isolated, living in certain places, environments. Certain communities are probably close. But generally speaking, from what I observe, being, for 40-some years on this planet, it seems like people could probably use and need a lot more companionship and friends than they have. Freedom. But I think, they need their freedom the most. Freedom or companionship? I think companionship, because if you're not free, at least if you have someone in prison with... it makes it a little more tolerable. So, but who knows? Maybe I'll change my mind on that one. But that's what I'm going to say. Companionship. Why does Charlie Carl enjoy scratching the carpet so much? Well, we haven't seen Charlie Carpet.
Charlie Carp. We haven't seen Charlie Carl in quite some time, actually. So, yeah, I'm going to have to see what... have you seen Charlie Carl Carpet on your travels to the sanitarium? All right. He's too busy playing his game. Making good progress. So why does he scratch the carpet so much? I think there's searching for something, maybe. Maybe he needs, he's trying to create his own, soothe himself, perhaps. Maybe something traumatic happened when he was, you know, something with involving carpet and being on the floor. I don't know, but if you ever just sitting around and you're near the carpet, if you just stop and listen, you can hear Charlie Carl scratching the carpet. Some things in life will just always remain a mystery. Are you living or are you existing? Kind of a simple question. Are you truly, it's kind of like, are you, you know, happy? Are you really living? Are you really enjoying yourself, living life to its fullest? Or are you just existing? You know, you're not happy. You're not able to enjoy life much. Whatever reason, I don't want to, I know this question can be kind of, I feel, I'm thinking now of people that might be, have a certain disability. It comes to mind as soon as I say this, so now I'm sorry, I feel like I want to walk on eggshells as I talk about this, explore this question. So, with those folks in mind, you know, it's kind of difficult, but as for me, you know, I feel that I'm living. If I'm in control, again, that is, and this isn't a simulation. I'm trying to live. You know, I'm definitely not just existing, enjoying myself and all that. So yeah, I mean, for me, I feel though. I'm living. At one point, I felt like I was existing, especially when working a job that I didn't like very much. I thought I was just existing. I was just waking up, going to the job, being a robot, you know. Yes, I will do this. Yes, I will obey. I need to make money, so let me do the same thing over and over again. That's just like, that's just existing, you know. And I had to do this so I could live. And, you know, also, you know, becoming a father and a husband has given me purpose, and now I'm living more that way as well. But it's interesting because it seems like, you know, the age of 40 is the magic number, because, you know, your 20s, your teens, your 20s, your mid-20s, you don't really know much. You know, you're still trying to explore the world. Your ego is very alive and all that. I mean, the ego doesn't really go away too much, but I guess depending upon how egotistical you are and all that and how you use it, but you're finding yourself, you know, and then you hit your 40s, and what question was this? And then you realize, for a lot of folks, that you weren't really living, you're just existing, and you kind of start to, maybe it's that middle-age crisis where you're like, well, I can be going at any time here, coupled with the fact that you weren't too happy, you know, doing such and such the first 20 or 30 years of your life, and you're tired of working for the man,
So now you want to take charge of your life and do some things you've thought about doing, and now it's the time to do it. So, yeah, I mean, I think I'm definitely living. I'm not existing anymore like I used to. So that's kind of my answer to that. Are humans headed in the right or wrong direction? That's a tough one. I think we seem to be heading in the right direction a little bit. It depends on what, how you look at that diamond, what angle you're looking at it from, or that box, or whatever the heck, the human race thing. What country do you live in? Here in the United States, we, like, for instance, same-sex marriage, we banned it, and now it's okay at a federal level, but I'm not really sure, state level. So kind of heading in the right direction in that regard. There's a lot more empathy and awareness about human rights and things, so we seem to be heading in the right direction in that regard. But then we're still with the deforestation and the nuclear power plants and all the energy and the lights, all the lights in the United States that are on 24/7 in office buildings that are empty. We keep these, you know, these lights running, which is just ridiculous. And so there's a waste of energy in that regard. And so overall, heading in the right or wrong direction? What is the right direction? What is the wrong direction? Yeah, we're animals. We don't even know if a God exists. We have no instruction manual. There's no instructions. No, we're just the earth, just to use a nice term, spat us out. And here we are. We're just a random creation, mutation of evolution. There's no manual, and we're just going about business. And think that we should probably learn to coexist in peace and harmony. Maybe, I don't know. Is that how we should live? Who's to say that's how we should live? Maybe it's to each their own. Get, accumulate, do what you want. You don't need to worry about nobody else. There's that aspect too. That's a possibility. I mean, you know, so I don't really know if we're heading in the right or wrong direction. I don't even know if there is a direction. No one has a clue what it is. That's for sure. It's a moving target. That's for sure. You know, you can't get every almost 8 billion people on the planet with all these different cultures. Like, there's like 2,000 languages or something like that. In all these different cultures, you can't get everybody on the same page and then say, let's go down this path. It's always going to be some turmoil. But what is the right, how are you going to feed everybody? So what's the right or wrong direction in regards to feeding 8 billion people and housing them? I think, you know, less poverty, economy in the United States seems to be helping with that, but not in other countries. So, and there's a lot of different ways to answer that question. So I don't, the right or wrong direction? The wrong direction when it comes to technology. Definitely. This is not how we should be living. I shouldn't be doing this. Should be living in a small community with some housing. I'm growing crops, taking care of the land, interacting with others, you know, and all that. But I was born into this system, and a lot of us are. Our humanity has been taken away from us. So we're not, so everyone has already hunted and gathered and made the food for you. You just got to go to the supermarket and buy it, with, as long as you get a job by working for someone else. So, you know, right or wrong direction? Probably
probably more leaning more towards the wrong direction, I think, overall. So, what is the true object of reality? Is it reality based on how humans perceive it? Is it the construct of our minds? Is it reality based on that of a fly, dog, elephant, or whale's perception? Look out, you see the sun, you see the landscape, you see other people, you see bugs. So the way we view life with our, these human eyes, is that the true object of reality? What about other creatures, how they view it? Now, we all seem to live on this orb, and it seems to be in a universe with a lot of other orbs, and stars, and planets, and stuff. And there seems to be this big, hot, fiery orb out there, the mass of molten whatever that makes up the sun. And there's a moon. So the way we perceive it seems to be like it would be the most objective reality and the truth, but is that the case? What about some other species on some other planet, some ethereal creature? What's that can see everything at an atomic level? Would you ever think about that? Everything is made up of atoms. What if we could see at an atomic level? You wouldn't be able to see that far because of all the atoms right in the air. It'd be so thick. I think they're spread out in the air a little bit. I'm not sure what the air would look like at an atomic level. But the wall, you would see molecules. I mean, that's what the wall is. But if you could actually see down at the quark level, the proton level, right? So, but we see things the way we see things. So what is the true object of reality? It's beyond my comprehension. Is there, when you talk about it being a construct of our minds, the way we see things is so that our brains can process it and understand it. So, there's death is next to me. There's a controller right there. If I pick it up, I can feel the angles to it and everything. Is the way we see things, and that's a true objective reality? It seems like it would be. Everything that I've experienced and touched and heard and have seen, and other people report the same things. So, but, what if you're able to see from a different perspective? How does a dog, dog's vision is a little different, but the eyes still kind of work the same, right? It sees the same tree we do, but it might be a little more, it's a little distorted, maybe a little bit. I don't know, when a fly looks at a tree or a whale looks at a, dives out of the water, what does a whale see? Same blue sky and clouds? So what is reality? I don't really delve into this question that much myself. I kind of just get stuck at everything that I see is reality. Stars and science and things that we explore. But that's just how we perceive things. There's a hologram theory about how the universe is a hologram, which I can't really wrap my monkey brain around. I have a limit to, believe it or not, I have a limit to my intelligence. Let's see, what's the next question? Do we ever, I think this is the last question. I think I've answered them all. So the last one is, do we have a responsibility to one another? Or are we just animals, and every person is each for themselves, survival of the fittest, etc.? I don't think we have a responsibility to each other. I can take from you if I want. I can do whatever I want as an animal to you. You mean nothing to me from a very objective
God, there's 8 billion people on this planet. Well, what do they mean to me? And not everyone means everything to me. It's impossible for every human being to mean something to everyone. Do I have a responsibility to 8 billion, to almost 8 billion people on this planet? No, of course not. It would be impossible for me to even tread on the rights of all 8 billion people. I think when I say you don't mean nothing to me, I don't seriously mean that. But objectively speaking, I'm an animal. There is no God. There's nothing waits for me after life. There's no, punishment waiting for me. No threat of eternal damnation and hellfire if I don't behave and do what the humans, want me to do, or some made-up God wants me to do. My responsibility towards others is just to not tread upon the freedoms of others out in the real world. When I go out there, I don't really get in anybody's way or prevent them from going about their business. That's kind of the same thing. It's if I can, being a godless animal, go steal from someone, but I would, that's wrong, even though it's material possessions, and those material possessions mean nothing. Really, that's someone else's property, and it's going to cause them stress because they probably don't understand that their material possessions don't mean anything, and they're very possessive about their material possessions. I'm not going to go kill nobody or anything like that. There are however many people living in poverty. For the first 20 years, for the first 10, 18 years of our lives, very self-centered and self-absorbed, probably the first 20, 25, 30. You are, each one of us is living our own life. We're trying to act and like we're heroes sometimes, and we're trying to save the world, but you can't. That's just a fantasy. It's unrealistic. There's how many people living in poverty right now? What's anyone doing about it besides the people that are actually volunteering to, give them medicine? What's my responsibility for everybody living in poverty, or everyone that's in jail, convicted of a crime? I don't think, from an objective animal viewpoint, that you have no responsibility. Responsibility, you answer to no one but yourself. And you don't have to help anyone if you don't want to. You can treat anyone however you want to treat them. I think it would be nice to treat everyone with kindness. That's out in the real world. When I go out there and I'm going on my nature walks, or I'm going to the supermarket, I'm not trying to push or shove anyone to get in line. I'm always like, yeah, go ahead all the time. I'm like, go ahead. If I'm waiting in line, there's someone else, I'm always like, no, you go first. There's always that. I think we don't really have a responsibility towards one another. You can live your life however you want. You don't have to share and all that. But the morals in society seem to dictate that we should be kind to one another. I guess so. But what about, if you have a problem with people in power that are treating other people a certain way, like in some other country that might be under communist rule, and they've perverted the true meaning of communism for their own, you know, for power, and how certain, you know, people living and working in sweatshops, what's my responsibility towards them? I can't help everyone. It's impossible. All we can do is hope that we all treat each other, our interactions, you know, in the real world are not necessarily kindness, but not impeding upon anyone's freedoms or, you know, mistreating them or anything like that, running a sweatshop or whatever it might be. It's almost to each their own, you know, whatever you want to do, really. Now, plenty of people don't help other people, not necessarily out of a lack of compassion, but you know, they just keep to themselves. They don't want nothing to do with other people for whatever reason. So you can't force people to be responsible towards one another. No. Community is important and companionship, but at the same time, you know, I think being individual and not having to, you know, be responsible with is just fine too. So it's, you know, when you're, like I was saying earlier, for the first 20 years of our lives, 18, just pick a number, say 18, you're just trying to get through school, you know, get a job, and think about what you're going to do with your life. You're not thinking about how you're going to help everyone that's living in poverty, how you're going to help someone that's been, every single person that's been wrongly convicted in jail. All these different cases and scenarios of people living in with hardships, facing hardships. You can't save everyone. Your 18 years of your life are focused on your own life and your own problems, if you have them, and overcoming those. And that's 8 billion people. 8 billion, 18, whatever the percentage is of those 8 billion people that are 18 years old, they are not worried about other people for the most part, okay? I mean, yeah, we all think about it, but what do thoughts, that don't mean nothing. You know, direct action is where it's at. You can post and blog and make a video and blah, blah, blah. That's all it is. And words and thoughts and prayers, they don't mean nothing. Direct action is what gets stuff done. You know, that's where the true heroes are. So, you know, the responsibility, so those first 18 years of your life, you're not thinking about helping someone else. I mean, occasionally you might volunteer. That's not everyone. So now I think we have a responsibility as far as making sure that everyone has their freedom to live their life how they want, and those freedoms should never be impeded upon or impeded, infringed upon, probably, maybe. But beyond that, you know, I don't think we have a responsibility towards one another. I think it would be nice to help each other when we can and all that. I have my own ideal utopian society. It's kind of leaning more towards anarcho-communist. I think that's how you say that. I've only dabbled into that theory a little bit. The human race, it's quite the puzzle, quite the conundrum. Just a myriad of people from so many different cultures and think you should live this way and that way, or worship this, or don't worship that. It's going to be the never-ending quest for answers and what's the right way to live. And again, you know, this is my perspective. Maybe the right, you know, there is no right or wrong way to live, I guess. So, responsibility towards one another? Kind of hard to say. Not really. Even, I mean, you don't even have to allow others to have their freedom. I mean, you can do whatever you want as a human being towards another human being. I'm not condoning anything illegal. Again, I'm just saying from objective view, there is nothing. There's no God that I can tell. There's nothing that really holds us back. So, but ideally, it would be nice if we were all truly free and we worked together as a true community out in the real world, and we didn't focus on money, and we were more neighborly, took care of one another more, you know, so that the elderly weren't ignored and just had to rely on social services, and we didn't have to rely on, you know, whatever. But it's very complicated. But ideally, my utopian society, that's how it would run. If I was a dictator in my utopian society, it'd be great. Trust me. All right. I think I talked long enough. If you're still, however far, even if you didn't get this far, you're not going to hear these words that I'm said, but you listened to the first 40 minutes. Thank you if you, for, you know, listening and for watching. And now maybe we're on the same wavelength as far as a lot of the ways we think and all that. Even if we don't agree, I think we can agree to disagree, and we can probably agree on certain things, you know. And we can all just learn to get along in the real world out there and find a better way to exist besides jails and governments and capitalism and all these ridiculous systems. So, but yeah, that's me. All right. Hope you enjoyed. Maybe you're falling asleep. I don't know. You got something done while you were listening to this. That works too. And take care, and see you in another video real soon. Bye-bye. Wish you all my best, by the way, as you journey down your own path in life, trying to figure out the answers to these questions. All right. See ya. You're still playing, yeah, you got pretty far. Oh, nice. Ooh. Yeah, I wouldn't have done that. Yeah, screw you too.